The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Corporation.
We're back. This is.
We sound echo, like we're in outer space. Echo. It's awesome.
This is Steve Sanson and Christina Ortiz with Veterans in Politics. We're going to have three guests today. We're going to have Billy Stojak, who is the parade chairman for the Veterans Day Parade.
I love that parade. Yeah. I've been in it 4 years. Yeah. I love that parade.
You've been in it?
Yeah.
I've never seen you.
I was in ROTC, so...
ROTC? Yeah. Oh, they still have that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, I didn't know that. I think I'm on the rock or something.
I believe that, and I think you're old, but, you know...
Whoa. Hold up.
But you're a cute old. You're a dignified old.
Hold up. Then we're going to have Lynn Goya, who's the Clark County clerk. You know they had a Clark County clerk?
I do. She signs your marriage license and all that. Oh. She's very nice.
Yeah, you met her?
She signs my marriage license, and that helps get my benefits taken care of. So.
Oh, so she's nice automatically.
She's very nice automatically, anybody who signs that.
And then we have James Ornchall, who is the current assemblyman, and he's going to vacate the seat to run for state senate.
That'd be cool. I'd look forward to that interview.
He's also a public defender. Did you know about that?
No, I didn't. And
he's a lawyer, one of those people.
One of those people, see.
Yeah. And today we, Jim Jonas is not going to be here today. I don't know what happened to Shyla Rose. I don't know what happened to her.
I've never met Shyla Rose, so you're...
She's supposed to be here. I don't know. Maybe there's traffic. People. Try calling her and we got disconnected. Or maybe she even hung up. Who knows? Maybe she thought I was a stalker or something.
I would be. You're not a stalker. You're a nice person.
Okay, good.
I wouldn't worry too much about that.
All right. That's why I have you on. Yeah. So, Christina, do you have any rants?
No, well, you know, I was talking to everybody about just our traffic problems and our congestion in the city and the mopeds and all, and just the impeding, how they impede traffic. And I hope maybe the assemblyman or the state senate will pass a bill because I feel like
to get rid of the mopeds
because I feel like if you can't keep up the speed limit, then you're just putting yourselves and other people in danger.
You know, that's funny because the assembly has, well, we have this law on the books right now. It's called impeding traffic. If you're too slow, you get a ticket. So why would they keep mopeds on the road that can't keep up?
Well, that's what I'm wondering. You know, if it's already a law in the book that you can't impede traffic like that, then why is it there?
Exactly. Maybe he could help us out with that.
I hope so. That's an assembly question.
Yeah, I think so. That was it?
Well, yes, and I want to give my kudos and a shout out to the soldiers who are walking the 58 miles that it will end today. One for every life that's lost in the 1 October shooting.
Oh, really?
They're active duty soldiers. And
oh, wow. I didn't know about that. That's happening here in Vegas?
That's happening right now.
Oh.
They will walk 58 miles up to the strip, and they had dog tags specially made for the one with each of the victims' names, and they'll go on the crosses there at the Las Vegas sign.
Okay. All right, very good. You don't have nothing else, right?
No, I don't have anything else.
Well, let's take a commercial break. Oh, well, before that, I just want to remind everybody that that next week we're going to be in the parade. And hopefully, you know, because I applied early for that parade. So hopefully.
Flanner's over there.
Hopefully we'll have a single digit number. You know, I'm just trying to single digit number, hopefully.
The gentleman's right there. You've got the master in charge.
Or a low double-digit number, like?
10?
10.
10's a good low-digit
number. 10's good,
I'll go 1 through 10.
Yeah. Hopefully.
All right.
So, and then after the parade, folks, we partnered with the Plaza Hotel and Casino, and at 2 p.m.
We can drink?
Yes.
That's the important part.
You, not me. I don't partake in the alcoholic beverage.
Ooh.
And then...
My teenage years make the difference.
Okay. And then at 2 p.m., we're going to be at the Plaza Hotel and Casino, and we're going to be giving away award certificates to veterans that have served, that have continued to serve our community.
That's cool. Yeah. And I am looking forward
out of uniform, out of uniform.
That's really cool. Yeah. And I can't wait to see all of them. And
So that should be fun. And County Commissioner Steve Sisolak is going to present it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And he's running for office too right now.
Yeah, he's running for a little thing called governor.
I heard that. So
A little job
called governor.
That's just it. So
it'll be cool to see him.
Yeah. So that should be fun. So next week is going to be fun. And we're still doing a show, but I won't be here.
Who is doing the show?
Jim Jonas is going to do it.
So who's doing the show?
Jim Jonas.
Is he going to be here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hopefully. Not like today, or else John will have to do it for us.
That would be.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll put John on.
So we're going to take a commercial break, folks. This is Steve Sampson, Christina Ortiz, Veterans of Politics. We're going to take a commercial break. We're going to come back with Billy Stojak, the chairman of the Veterans Day Parade. Be right back, folks.
Good afternoon. This is Jim Jonas, host of Veterans in Politics. We are a video and internet radio show, live every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Television. Our mission is to educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and intelligently vote for those candidates whom would help create a better world to protect ourselves from our own governments in a culture of corruption, and to be the political voice for those and other groups who do not have one. So listen to us live every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Television. Or, if you miss that opportunity, it's okay. You can listen and watch our archive broadcast by going to www.wwdbtv.com or simply Google Veterans in Politics and it will link you right over. It will also give you a list of our upcoming shows, so you can do some research and call in to ask questions. The number is 702-685-8380. If you truly want to be informed and make educated voting decisions, Veterans in Politics is the place to go. We are nonpartisan, have no agenda but to help you get the information you need to make a educated voting decision. Remember, the person who doesn't educate themselves and exercise their right to vote is only adding to corruption in government. Don't be that person. Listen every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. to Veterans of Politics. For more information regarding VIPI, visit www.veteransinpolitics.org.
Folks, we're back. This is Steve Sampson and Christina Ortiz of Veterans in Politics. We have William Stojak, who's the chairman for the Veterans Day Parade. Mr. Stojak, how you doing today, sir?
I'm doing great.
Yeah, you look good. You look good.
Herding cats.
What do you do to keep so young? What do you
keep moving?
Oh, you keep moving. How old are you, by the way?
I am 71.
Oh, beautiful. I've known you how long?
At least 10, 12.
Too long.
Time flies when you're in a coma.
Well, this is the first time you've met?
This is the first time I've met.
Oh, wow. That's why you're closer, so you can introduce yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, I've been, I've worked out of Las Vegas since 71.
Okay. Oh, wow.
And seen the town grow.
Yeah.
Get better in some ways.
You know, matter of fact, give us your bio. Come on.
Just from key Detroit. Points. I moved here. I had relatives here since 47.
Okay.
Served in Southeast Asia in the Navy.
Navy guy,
sailor.
Chauffeur.
Thank you for your service, by the way.
Thank you for yours and everybody's service. Had a very successful.
She was Army, so.
Okay, hey, somebody's got to be.
I just couldn't imagine standing on a boat with that many people or that close to that many people.
I never spent any time in the Wavy Navy. Well, yeah, I had a little
How long
bit,
were you in Navy for?
I did 6 years active, then reserve components.
When did you get out?
Where?
When?
Actually, I set full-time separation in 82, actually. Went into reserve components. And Had a very successful career at the Clark County Fire Department.
Really? I didn't know you were a fireman.
Thank you for that service as well.
Had the Grand Hotel fire and the Hilton.
So you were the MGM fire? The first MGM?
14 days.
Oh, wow.
Straight through.
So you were a fireman for how long?
24 years.
Oh, wow. So what made you get into parade chairing and all that stuff?
What really took place is...
Well, but before you answer that, sure. Do you do all the parades or you just do the Veterans
Day? Just the Veterans Day parade.
Okay.
That's kind of fully consuming.
Walk us through that process.
What took place is we had a group of World War II and Korean War veterans, mm-hmm. God bless them, out of, I want to say, the American Legion,
okay.
that had done the Veterans Day parades.
Right.
In Las Vegas, and 27 years ago, it was down to one World War II vet.
Right,
he was the only one left standing, and he, crusty old dude, and he goes, "I can do it." And right. 6 weeks before the parade, he fell and broke his hip.
Wow.
So the powers that be said, "Well, it's the end of the parade." So you know how it is in the military. Bad news travels fast.
Right.
Just a bunch of us unaffiliated vets that had been in the parade previously said, oh, no, this yeah. can't happen.
Yeah.
So we appeared before the city council.
Yeah.
And said,
What year was this?
What would it be, 80?
If it was 27 years ago, you're at 80, 90.
90. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And we said, hey, this is, you know, we keep hearing in our community that... gee, we don't have any culture. Uh-huh. Well, this is an inherent part of the culture of the community. We've got to have the parade.
Right.
And they kind of wobble around. So we said, well, how about we attempt, we'll do the parade.
Right.
Wow, you know, there, at this time there was 3 or 4 weeks left.
Right.
We said, well, we're vets. We're used to doing more with less, and we can set up a chain of command and just don't impede us. Oh, okay, go ahead. So we pulled it off. We had no support, no funding.
No support, no funding.
Nothing, nada.
Wow.
I was, being outspoken as I am, I had the privilege of filling out the parade application for the first time. That was interesting. How many entrants? 100.
How many entrants actually showed up the first time?
Probably 60 or so.
60's not bad.
No, it was great.
How many people do you think?
I'm not good at estimating crowds, but I'd say probably 10, 12,000 people.
And it was still video by the news and all that?
Yes, yes.
So
and we just, you know, how many in attendance? 10,000. You know, as they say, I gun decked it.
Right.
And the most illuminating thing was I'd finished the application, which I believe at the time was 2 pages. And this upper middle level bureaucrat shoves me a stack of papers. It's about 1/8 of an inch thick. And I go, what's this? She says, oh, it's your application to be recognized by the city of Las Vegas right. as a special interest group. And I went, never really looked at it that way. Okay,
right.
But since you brought it up, we're the senior special interest group in the country.
Yeah.
Can you say 1776? And they kind of backed off. So I'm proud to say we've taken it. We're now, this is per CNN,
right.
the largest parade west of the Mississippi.
Really?
I was just about to say that a couple years ago.
So,
I was reading that.
And I'm proud to say we made a new landmark this year. We have entrants from Norway.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Norway.
Very cool.
I just received an email 2 days ago from a group of veterans in Norway that are going to be in Las Vegas. During and asked if they could participate. I said, absolutely.
So how many entries do you have now?
At this, they keep coming in.
Ballpark. Last year, how many?
I want to say we had 108 last year.
Okay.
This year, we're already at 100.
Okay.
And with the time, we always get people that don't get the word.
And what about the crowd? What about the crowd?
I think the crowd, because of the current, the past recent unpleasantness is going to be way over the top.
Really?
Well, and I think the day is going to be great because Veterans Day this year is a Saturday, so
Well, that plays into it, but that's part of the what we feel is a cornerstone of the parade.
Right.
Since it rotates because of the calendar years, Alan Stock and I made a command decision about a decade ago that, hey, the 11th, 11th month, 11th day, 11th hour. It was Armistice Day.
Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter when.
We don't care when
what
it
day?
Is. And the rationale, and we get complaints from different groups.
It's a Saturday.
Yeah,
it's a Monday.
At the Sunday.
You can't please everybody.
My answer to that, I go, hey, you guys, isn't your group combat vets? Well, yeah. So did you take the day off? And I go, my experience, I didn't even know what day it was.
True. Yeah.
Didn't care.
Yeah.
I said, so we're not about to let it mutate into being a convenience item for a three-day barbecue weekend.
Yeah.
That's not the way it is. Yeah. So we've taken that stance, and we're holding to it.
Okay. Good for you.
It maintains integrity of the whole concept.
So how do you get your commentaries and those people that sponsor and how do you get all those cops out there?
The cops we pay for. Okay, that's one of our biggest bills.
That's your big budget.
Yeah, big.
What's the budget for the police over there?
I want to say this year it was roughly $7,618.
Did we have to up the security with recent events?
I've had several meetings with my liaison, who's our 4-0 outstanding guy, at Metro in the event section, and with the city, reference security issues, and we think we've got a good handle on it. There's going to be a larger law enforcement.
Yeah, I'm not going to even ask the logistical thing because I think that's the less people know, the better.
Exactly.
And has it always been downtown, right on that same
Fourth Street? It's always been on 4th Street. Mm-hmm. We made a big... We've been leaders in a lot of areas. When the parade started to grow and get larger and larger, I had a concern about commingling marching groups, Cub Scouts, with large military vehicles, a safety issue. So we took that to the city and said, hey, how can we expand our staging areas? I don't want to commingle kids. You get a small individual, and one of those big, a kid wouldn't even be a speed bump. They wouldn't even know it. So they say, well, we'll try it. So now in every parade, every event uses it. We stage all wheeled and motorized vehicles south of Charleston on 4th Street. And I have an assistant parade marshal down there with the lineup, and we get help from the Navy recruiting folks. And then all marching groups are staged north of Charleston to the west of 4th Street, and they're fed in at Coolidge. So we have marshals there that get them in a semblance of numerical order. And then if you have a mixed group, then they're fitted together right there at Coolidge. It's a system that seems to work rather
well. So it's starting at 10 a.m.?
Yes. I recommend to get good seats. Get there as early. Bring a lawn chair. Have a nice time. Bring the kids. We're going to be one of our major sponsor, MGM, is handing out. We have 8,000 American flags to hand out.
Very cool.
So we've historically handed those out before the parade. It's such a wonderful feeling. I've done it myself several years to hand out all those flags. And not only do the veterans just love to see the Stars and Stripes wave, but if that's what it takes to get a kid to take home a flag and put it in their room, it's worth the effort.
Right. No,
and I have never, to this day, found one of those flags laying on the deck after the parade. Right. So that means you're going home.
Yeah. That's really
cool. What's the craziest float you've ever seen?
Lonnie Hammergren.
All right, I guess.
Need I say more?
Yes, there's all
Do I have to elaborate?
Okay.
The other one is the 3x life-size buffalo that came from Buffalo Jim Barrier.
Okay.
Another colorful
individual. In fact, we had a complaint from one group of veterans one year that they had to go the entire, they were behind the buffalo. Okay. And
I got mad.
Of course, the old story, unless you're the lead sled dog, the pew never changes. Right. Okay. So they took it personally. Oh. And we go, no, that was not the intent. Right. You know, it just, somebody's got to be behind the buffalo.
All right.
And along those lines, we made a command decision. Our board, there's several of us that have involvement in it. I don't make the decisions arbitrarily on what we do. It's, you know, like a staff meeting. We made a command decision many years ago to get a semblance of order. Group A is, we have the color guard. We have distinguished veterans, sometimes severely injured veterans, right behind the color guard.
So those are our Purple Hearts.
That's the current war on terror that we're involved in. In my day, if you lost a limb in combat, you were pretty much gone.
Yeah.
We'll get your body back. We're not going to leave you behind. Today, this is modern battlefield trauma medicine. It's a double-edged sword, because you can have multiple amputees, and because of the level of care and the speed, they're survivable injuries. Yeah. So I'd never denigrate anybody that's paid the ultimate price, but then these troops are going to pay you the rest of their lives.
Yeah. Right.
So we
honor. It's a constant reminder.
Yeah. And it, so there's pros and cons to all that. But then we have our city and our county, you know, the commissioners and the council people, because they support it so much. Then we have the emergency services. We have city fire, we have county fire, we have metro. And we rethemed this year's parade. We hadn't announced it before, but it's for veteran first responders. Because there's so much crossover in that field. We have an enormous amount of law enforcement officers, firefighters, and paramedics, EMTs, that are prior service, and they're giving back to the community.
So the participants won't know where to go until that day.
Exactly. Right. We ran into a problem, and of course, this is part of it. I fend off the phone calls. This is part of herding cats. Right. I routinely get... well, we entered the parade. What number are we? And I go, are you going to go down 2 weeks early and, you know, get in line? Yeah. Go to the rally point, the staging area. It's called out on our website, veteransparadelv.com. You can pull up the stage yourself, and then send one or two people to registration at 4th and Hoover, sign in, which is a multiple function. We know you're there.
Right.
We issue your number assignment, and we give you your battle streamer. Yeah. Every year we've given out battle streamers so groups can fly them, as you know, from their colors, okay? And we get an outstanding one this year. Everybody will love it.
Bill Stojak, we ran out of time. I want to thank you for coming on the program, but I want you to look in the camera and tell people what they need to do, what they shouldn't bring, or what the basic rules are, and your point of contact.
Bring water, okay? Bring lawn chairs. One of the best vantage points, if you can get there early, is the Fremont Street Experience parking garage. Second, third, and fourth floor gives you an outstanding view of the parade. The reviewing stands is at Ogden and 4th Street. We have VIP bleachers across from that. There will be three sets of bleachers set up, two of them open to the general public, first come, first served. We have a flyover that will be at 1000 hours sharp. We suggest everybody gets there 8:30, enjoy it. The weather's supposed to be gorgeous, 74, clear skies. Enjoy the parade and the ambiance of your veterans community, and help us celebrate it.
Well, thank you so much, Bill Stojak.
Thanks for having me.
Folks, that's Billy Stojak. He is the chairman for the Veterans Day Parade, which is the largest parade west of the Mississippi. This is Steve Sanson, Christine Ortiz with Veterans in Politics. But don't go away, folks. We're going to have Lynn Goya, who's the Clark County Clerk. We'll be right back.
Good afternoon. This is Jim Jonas, host of Veterans in Politics. We are a video and internet radio show, live every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Television. Our mission is to educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and intelligently vote for those candidates whom would help create a better world to protect ourselves from our own governments in a culture of corruption, and to be the political voice for those and other groups who do not have one. So listen to us live every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Television. Or, if you miss that opportunity, it's okay. You can listen and watch our archive broadcast by going to www.wwdbtv.com or simply Google Veterans in Politics and it will link you right over. It will also give you a list of our upcoming shows, so you can do some research and call in to ask questions. The number is 702-685-8380. If you truly want to be informed and make educated voting decisions, Veterans in Politics is the place to go. We are nonpartisan, have no agenda but to help you get the information you need to make an educated voting decision. Remember, the person who doesn't educate themselves and exercise their right to vote is only adding to corruption in government. Don't be that person. Listen every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. to Veterans of Politics. For more information regarding VIPI, visit www.veteransinpolitics.org.
Folks, we're back. This is Steve Sanson, Christina Ortiz with Veterans in Politics. We have Lynn Goya, who's the current Clark County Clerk. Miss Clerk Goya, is that how you call yourself?
Madam.
Madam Clerk. is that proper? Madam Clerk?
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I started as a Clark County Clerk in 2015. Before that, I was a freelance writer. For 5 years, I was the managing editor for Veteran Journal, online publication that talked about veterans issues.
Oh, wow.
So I was a freelance writer.
I didn't even
writer.
Know that.
I think I've told you before, Steve.
I'm getting old.
Yeah, I know. Everybody forgets. So I have three kids, moved to Nevada in 93.
The youngest is how old?
23.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we love it here. We
Any
love
grandkids?
This part of the
grandkids?
Year. No, I'm no? ready when they are.
Oh. Go ahead.
Why did you run for Clark?
Well, I've been involved in politics on the backside for quite a long time, helping other candidates get elected. And
she said, "Hell with them, I'm getting elected now."
Well, yeah, actually, when Diana Alba, the current county clerk, retired, she approached me and asked me if I was interested in running. And I looked at what the office did, and I thought it was a good fit, and so I ran.
Well, tell us about this office
because I don't know much about the county clerk at all.
What do they do? How many people work for you? What's the objective?
We have almost 50 people on staff. We bring in about $8.5 million a year.
Okay.
To the county, it goes to the general fund. Right. A lot of it comes back to us, but less than half. And we do three major things. We do a lot of little things on top of it, but the first thing is obviously we're the secretary for the county boards, including the new stadium board and the
talking
board
about
commissions.
The board of county commissions.
Yeah. All the different boards, the water board, board of equalization.
So you sit on all these boards?
We do. And we keep the records and make sure that these are permanent, accurate records so that the public knows what happened and who voted for what and what contracts got assigned and all that.
So that's you doing all that?
Well, not me personally, my staff.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so what boards do you particularly sit on?
No,
or you sit on all
the clerk sits on all
but I don't
oh, okay. the clerk sits on all
the but I don't capability to be at all meetings
right and I don't take all the notes myself
okay
I let other staff do
I thought you cloned yourself
and, I did yeah it'd be nice I do literally sit on the boards at some of the meetings but not all of them I don't go to all of them I'm not able to go to all of them so one of the things that's really interesting with that part of my job is that we have public records going back to 1909 when the county formed, the original when Boulder City was formed, right. when you know, Yucca Mountain was formed. And so one of the things that I've been working on is to digitize all of the records going back to 1909.
Okay.
And I've been working on that for a few years. We got the funding and the resources, so we hope to have the entire public record archives for the county boards done by next summer. And then we're developing a Google-like search application so that you'll be able to go online right. and look for all the public records, do those searches yourself, and see right. whatever you want to see within the county records.
So if someone wanted to see the county records now, where would they have to go, or what would they have to do?
The recent county records are already digitized, so you can go online and look at agendas, and then you'll mm-hmm. pick what board and which meeting and all those, and you can see that. But the older ones are not. So if you want records from them, you come to the clerk's office on the sixth floor of the government center, or you email us and say we'd like X, Y, and Z. And then, you know, the records are 100 years old, mm-hmm. over 100 years old. So there's obviously been more than one clerk
right.
in that time. And everyone has kind of their own filing method. So it would be very hard for anybody else to go in and find anything in a systematic way. But, you know, our staff knows how to find it. So that would be the process. You ask our staff and we pull mm-hmm. it.
Oh, so where's your office located?
The clerk's office has five different offices. My mm-hmm. administrative office is on the fifth floor of the RJC, the Regional Justice Center.
Okay.
That's also where the Marriage License Bureau is, which is another big portion of...
So you do that too as well?
Absolutely. We do okay. all portions of marriage licensing.
Not that I don't know. I just want everybody else.
I know. So we...
you notice they don't ask questions you don't already know the answer.
Yeah,
to.
I know these answers. So we issue marriage licenses. In 2015, we took over filing marriage certificates right. from the recorder's office.
Right.
And then we license officiants, people that want to become legally able to marry couples. And so we maintain pretty much all of the marriage documents and marriage industry. So one thing I found when I started running was that marriage industry had declined about almost 40% in the past decade.
Right.
When I looked in it further, it's actually been declining since 2000. It's a $2.5 billion industry for Clark County, so it's something that we don't want to lose.
$2.5 billion industry for the marriage.
Through the clerk's office, but the marriage industry.
Oh,
like
the marriage
people
industry.
People getting married, yes. buying flowers, staying.
You're talking about nationwide.
No, I'm talking about Clark County.
Oh, Clark County. Wow, yeah, that's a large number.
You've heard this thing. Run
no,
off
you,
and get
you know, you know, you know what I want to ask about, Madam Clerk, is that Nevada has been getting new revenue streams.
Mm-hmm.
First it was medical marijuana, then it was recreational marijuana, now it's everybody's marijuana, and then, you know, they pull all those tax
right.
dollars from that.
Right.
But they now in your department, you also have a same-sex marriage.
Mm-hmm.
How much of an increase is that revenue brought to the table since that law has been passed here in the state?
It's only about 5% of the marriage licenses that we issue, so it would be
5%. So the number's low?
The number's not.
How much is that in dollars? I like
geez.
Money. How much would you?
You know, Steve, I'd have to have like
say?
A piece of paper.
That is
if we bring in $4.5 billion and it's 5% of that.
That's a lot of money.
It's still a lot of money.
Oh, yeah. $4.5 billion
and
5%.
Year. Per year.
Oh, that's a lot of money. I'll take 5% of $4.5 billion.
Well, that's right. Any of us would take that. I think that would be a good deal. But it's spread about over 16,000 people
okay.
depend on wedding tourism for their mm-hmm. livelihood. So it's an important sector.
Right.
And I think you were talking, you know, something that you just said a minute ago, you know, we're doing all these new things, but we need to make sure that we retain our old things as
okay.
well.
Right.
We still are considered the wedding capital of the world.
Mm-hmm.
We still marry more people. More people come here than any other place in the world. But we want to make sure that that sector is robust
right.
and active. And I
so your busy day is Valentine's Day, right?
It's a very
or
busy day.
Or is it my birthday?
It's probably your birthday, Steve.
Oh, okay, good. That's when everybody wants to go out and get married, right?
Well, actually, this Veterans Day weekend is going to be a big project for us. So,
really?
One of the things that I did when I started office is to kind of start to get the wedding community to work more closely together, and so we started the first Las Vegas Wedding Chamber of Commerce, the first Chamber of Commerce, wedding Chamber of Commerce in the world that we are aware
right.
of, and with that, a clerk is partnering with them. It's a public-private
okay.
partnership, and then this November 10th, to set off Veterans Day weekend. Right. We are marrying some of the military for free. Wow. So we did a promotion. Oh, cool. We reached out to the wedding community. Okay. We're doing about 12 weddings and vow renewals at places all across the valley. It's really fun. Everybody jumped in, mm-hmm. From the Aria to the Wynn Chapel. Wow. Ace Chapel downtown, a little chapel, the Bellagio.
So you deal with these wedding chapels on a personal level?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
And why does a clerk have to deal with the wedding chapels? What's the connection there? I know one gives the license, the other one marry, but anything more than that, what's the connection?
Well, it's the wedding industry. The clerk is probably the most closely aligned with the wedding industry in general, because the licenses, the officiants, all those kinds of things.
Anybody ever come to the office showing up all drunk? Oh, I want to marry Christina.
I would say.
And anybody come like that? And do you? I mean, what's your criteria if they're too intoxicated? You don't give them a license. I mean, is there a policy in place that
there's
you guys
absolutely
have?
A policy in place. If you think about it. And not in a negative way, but if you think about it, marriage license is probably the most important contract you sign in your life. It gives you all sorts of benefits for veterans or for active duty military. Right. Now you can get benefits from that if a person
or you get your account drained by the other person.
Well, you could. I said not negative. But, you know, if a person is injured or dies in duty, you get death benefits. Right. If you're married, if you're just living together, you don't do that. The person can earn Social Security benefits for their spouse. If there's some legal or medical decisions, you are equipped to get that if you're married. There's really no other contract that you could create that gives you the benefits you get from marriage.
You know, in California, they got this thing called common law marriage. I think after 5 years, I forget what
you know. I think most states have outlawed common law.
Oh, they outlawed the common law?
Yeah,
because when I was there, they still had the common law. Yeah, and that was like 22
years
ago.
Nevada definitely doesn't have common law.
Yeah,
marriage.
I know that. Do you believe in common law marriage, or you don't believe in that? And,
well,
and how
I mean,
could you even prove it anyways?
Yeah, and I don't think it's an issue. I think that was one of the problems. So if you're going to get married, you need to get married. I want to make sure that when you get married, you have a contract you can count on. Right. One of the people, and this was a veteran that came to my office right after I got into office, and they'd been married 30 years, and they were going to do a vow renewal with their kids, and they couldn't find their marriage certificate. It had never been filed. And so that means that wedding and all of their rights were in jeopardy, right?
Well,
because they couldn't prove they were married. Even if you say that you're married, the Social Security or Veterans Administration is not going to accept that.
They need to exterminate this place. I'm just saying. You saw that bug crawling?
I did see that bug. It distracted me.
We're moving.
So they'd been married 30 years. They couldn't prove their marriage certificate. There was no marriage certificate. They didn't have any, like many veterans, including a lot of them that were doing the vow renewals on Friday. You know, that was a quickie marriage. They didn't have any pictures. They had not told their parents ahead of time. Elvis wasn't there. They had no way to prove that they had actually been married. And he had been in basic training. He flew back to get married to her, and then they both moved back. And so they thought she's crying, he's shaking, they're thinking their children are illegitimate. It was a very big deal. So we were able to recreate the marriage certificate and file it so that they did have all those benefits that they had really counted on.
Right. Any crazy stuff you've seen since you've been clerk over there?
Well, Vegas, because there's so many people that come here, 80% are tourists that get married here. Mm-hmm. And because there's so many people, we do get ones that think that they can scam and, you know, get it through here. So we had actually an 86-year-old guy coming in with an 85-year-old woman from New York to get married. And her children called and said, they're coming. She's not competent. He's going to say he's her legal guardian. He is not her legal guardian.
Okay.
And so clearly they were trying to get money before she passed away. So
we
did refuse to issue the license. If someone does come in and is too drunk or for whatever reason you don't think they're competent, then we do refuse the license.
So people just could come here and get married without having any establish any residency, right?
There's no residency requirements and there's no waiting. So you can get your license. We're open from 8 a.m. until midnight, 365 days a year, holidays every single day. And
really?
And you can do the application online, right?
Yeah, that's one of the innovations that we did when we took over the marriage certificate filing process. So you can file online no matter where in the world you are. That's right. Open 24 hours a day. And then when you come in, you just have to show your ID. So right. All of it's completed. It really is cut down on the amount of time it takes to wait in line and right. All those things.
Well, Madam Clerk, I would love to talk to you a little bit more, but in the interest of time, we have to part ways.
Anytime, Steve.
But you're running for re-election.
Oh, I am definitely going to run for re-election.
Could you look in the camera? Could you look in the camera and tell folks why they need to go back to the polls and vote for you, and what you've accomplished since you've been there, and your point of contact?
Absolutely. My website is lynnmariegoya.com, my election website. The reason I want to run and get in is because I haven't got everything done that I wanted to get done. We're in the process of getting the digitization of the county commission records done, but there's a lot more that I need to get done. We'd like to do the fictitious firm names. We'd like to get that online so it's easier for people to refile their fictitious firm name. There's a lot to get done that I would like to be in office to accomplish. So thank you.
And your point of contact. Did you say that?
Yeah, lynnmariegoya.com.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Madam Clerk. Folks, that's Lynn Goya. She's the current Clark County Clerk and running for re-election. This is Steve Sanson and Christina Ortiz with Veterans in Politics. But don't go away. We have James Ornchall, the current Assemblyman for the state of Nevada, who's running for U.S. who's running for state Senate. We'll be right back.
Good afternoon. This is Jim Jonas, host of Veterans in Politics. We are a video and internet radio show. Live every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Television. Our mission is to educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and intelligently vote for those candidates whom would help create a better world to protect ourselves from our own governments in a culture of corruption, and to be the political voice for those and other groups who do not have one. So listen to us live every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Television. Or, if you miss that opportunity, it's okay. You can listen and watch our archive broadcast by going to www.wwdbtv.com or simply Google Veterans in Politics and it will link you right over. It will also give you a list of our upcoming shows, so you can do some research and call in to ask questions. The number is 702-685-8380. If you truly want to be informed and make educated voting decisions, Veterans in Politics is the place to go. We are nonpartisan, have no agenda but to help you get the information you need to make a educated voting decision. Remember, the person who doesn't educate themselves and exercise their right to vote is only adding to corruption in government. Don't be that person. Listen every Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. to Veterans of Politics. For more information regarding VIPI, visit www.veteransinpolitics.org.
Here. Folks, we're back. This is Steve Sanson, Christina Ortiz of Veterans in Politics. We have James Ornchall, who's the current Nevada State Assemblyman, who's a candidate for Nevada State Senate. Assemblyman Ornchall, how are you doing?
Good afternoon, Steve, Christina. Thank you very much for inviting me to be on the show. It's a pleasure to be here.
Tell us about you.
Well,
you know, I could have you here like all day long.
Well,
you've been in session for a long time.
I've been very fortunate to get to represent my constituents since 2006. I'm a native Nevadan. I was born here in Las Vegas, Nevada, 1970s. I don't want to say how long ago, but I was born in the 1970s. I grew up in Las Vegas, saw our community grow and change. I went to local schools. I went to UNLV for my undergraduate degree. And
you didn't go to Boyd, right?
I did. I went to Boyd Law School. I decided to go to Boyd Law School and become an attorney, and was able to finish that and practice and be able to represent my constituents in the assembly. And I'm very lucky to be happily married, a father of two boys. And,
are you Mormon? Are you a Mormon?
No, I'm not.
Okay, so two
everybody raised here is Mormon.
No, because, you know, two boys, I figure he's going to get three more, and then that's the set number.
My wife says we're done.
Oh,
we're done.
He can't even go to the Mormon club.
No.
But, two boys, no, it's too little.
Love them to death, and it certainly changes the way I work on bills, because you know you have to think about you know their future and the future of our community. I'm not a veteran, but my
Shame
dad.
On you for that.
Well, I'm not a veteran, but my dad is a veteran. My dad was drafted into the Army during the Korean conflict. Okay. He ended up staying stateside, but he's a veteran. My stepdad's actually a World War II veteran, combat veteran, who fought in North Africa and in Europe.
Oh, wow.
So while I'm not a veteran, I do have veterans in my family, and I'm proud of legislation I've worked on in the Assembly that I believe helps veterans.
But before you do that, you were an attorney, and you were for the Public Defender's Office, right?
That's correct.
The juvenile division?
I do.
Because
I work in juvenile court.
I've seen you at family court a lot.
I work in at the Juvenile Public Defender's Office, and what I do there is I represent children who have either been cited or arrested, who have gotten in trouble with the law. Right. And a lot of those children have a lot of issues going on in their life. A lot of them have undiagnosed mental health issues, undiagnosed substance abuse issues, and a lot of them don't have a stable home or things are going on
in
their
or
lives.
Mother.
That's true, a lot of those kids. And so I am probably one of the luckiest attorneys in the country in that my job is to try to help children, and and I get to try to connect them with resources that can help them if there's a drug abuse issue, if there's a mental health issue. And the whole model of juvenile court is not a model that's meant to try to punish the child. Right. It's meant to try to provide services that can help that child not end up back in the system. And as a juvenile public defender, I have a very privileged position in that I get to try to connect kids with those services that will help them, whether it's housing instability, whether it's substance abuse, whether it's mental health issues. And there's a lot of children who end up
in
the system.
Sounds like a full calendar. How do you have time to be in assembly?
Well, I try to balance both to the best I can. And I'm very lucky that during the legislative session, I'm able to take a leave of absence and go
Phil
up to Carson City.
Will Phil Cone give you a leave of absence all the time?
I do. When I have to go up to Carson City, I do take a leave of absence. I go up to Carson City.
So you get no pay from the public defender's office?
Not while I'm up in Carson City, no.
Oh, wow. So you're losing money then?
Well, I'm very lucky to get to serve. So
it's
an opportunity for me to try to help my
community.
You're saying
all the damn right answers.
And, I'm lucky in both my day job and my part-time job with the legislature to try to help the community where I can.
Well, and I've known you for years, so I know what you say is true. You're very humble. You do care. I know that. There's some people that go up there that only care about themselves, but you do care about the community.
I appreciate that. That means a lot, Steve. Thank you for your kind words. And I think that the 12 years I've served, I haven't accomplished everything I've wanted to accomplish, but I think here and there, every session, I've been able to try to help.
I want to congratulate you on being such a success story, born and raised in Nevada.
Thank you.
And how cool that is.
She's jealous.
I'm a native Nevadan, too, born and raised in the same city. But I got the cool privilege of reading over your notes. And a lot of I'm just in awe about, the staple of bills you have of all the legislative that you've done and been able to accomplish in your 12 years. Why State Senate now?
Well, I'd like to continue to get to represent my neighbors and my friends. And I was first elected to the Assembly in 2006, and I've been fortunate every 2 years.
You took your mom's...
My mother did serve, and she retired, and I ran.
How long was she there for?
She served for 12 years. She was first elected in 1994, and when she retired, I ran. And
took her seat.
Yes, I did.
So they kept
in Assembly 12.
Name?
Yes. Yeah, and I've been fortunate to serve for the last 12 years. And I can't run for Assembly. I'm actually constitutionally termed out the Assembly. I've been fortunate to serve the last 12 years. So there's an opening State Senate, and I'd like to continue to represent my constituents, my neighbors in that State Senate district.
Mark Menendez's seat?
Yes, Senator Menendez resigned, so there's an opening. Okay. And as to the legislation I've worked on that I believe helps veterans, 2009, I was a co-sponsor of the first bill that created a veterans court in Nevada, which is a therapeutic court, which when someone who is a veteran ends up in the criminal justice system, it tries to look at alternatives
to
incarceration.
About the one in 2008, the one that Barbara Buckley...
Right, I was a co-sponsor of that, and then...
I don't remember you being the co-sponsor.
I was a co-sponsor of that, and then this last session, very proud of bills that were brought by Assemblyman Elliot Anderson and Senator Cannizzaro that really broadened the veterans courts in Nevada.
You know, one thing I don't like about that, because it says may in there. Before it used to be shall, and then they change it all to may. That means, I could do it, or I don't want to do it.
Well,
that's what
as you know, Steve.
And then the unfunded mandates, that's another thing. They we made that court system, but we didn't have there was no plan to get dollars into that program.
Well, that may be something that has to be remedied next session. And as you know, Steve, in terms of getting a bill to the finish line and to the governor's desk, a lot of times there is a lot of compromising. Yeah. And sometimes, you know,
but
the funds aren't...
But why should a bill, why should anybody compromise if a bill is a good bill? And the thing that I don't like, because I go up to session since 04, and you've seen me up there a bunch of times.
Sure have, and I know you've testified and advocated in a lot of bills.
And when we even run into each other at the airport in Reno. But one thing I don't like is when they play partisan politics on a good bill, when just because somebody is a Republican or a Democrat and their name is on the bill, and somebody from a different party sees it, be like, and just toss it, and it's a good bill. But because that person is a R or a D, they toss it away, whatever their bias might be. That part I don't like about the legislation.
And
how can we fix that part?
That's a good question.
If it's a good bill, it shouldn't matter if it's an R or a D on there. I mean, if I'm a Republican and I'm in charge of Ways and Means, let's say, and you submitted a bill to me and you're a D and I'm looking at it and I'm like, oh, James Archer, Democrat, I don't want it. No, it should be what's the betterment of the community? What's going to help Nevadans?
And
no matter who's on there.
I believe there's been less of that in the 12 years I've been serving in the assembly. That there's been more attempts at trying to look at the idea and look at the bill and not say, oh, this is a Democrat issue or a Republican issue. And if it's something that
should be a Nevadan issue,
it should be. And I think that we've been moving towards that little by little. Can you ever get rid of that? I'm not sure you can in a two-party system. But I think that we have been trying to make sure that if the idea is good, it doesn't get shelved if it's a Republican or a Democrat or chairman. Does it need improvement? It obviously does, and I hope that that's something that we'll see more and more of as we continue.
So 12 years is quite a feat. It passed a lot of bills and sponsored a lot of bills. What is the one that you are most proud of?
The one that I'm most proud of is... In 2008, Speaker Buckley appointed me to an interim committee to study the issues affecting kids who have autism. And the issue we heard during that interim was not only did insurance not cover kids who have autism, but in most insurance policies in Nevada, they specifically excluded any treatment for kids with autism.
Excluded
any coverage. And I introduced a bill in 2009 that said that if you have a private insurance policy or insurance through most work coverages, that it would have to cover treatment for kids with autism. Mm-hmm. Some of my colleagues said it'll never pass. You're not going to be able to get a mandate on. And at that time, the Democrats controlled the legislature, and Governor Gibbons was the governor. He was a Republican. Right. And most people said if it did pass, he'll veto it. He's not going to sign a new insurance mandate into law. But we got it through, and he signed it. And I believe Nevada was the 12th or 13th state in the country that covered treatment for kids who are on the spectrum. And I believe that has helped a lot of kids become functioning adults and go a lot farther than they could have before.
Absolutely.
So that's probably the bill I'm most proud of.
And what bill you're not so proud of?
What bill am I not so proud of?
That passed, and you had nothing to do with it. You're like, eh.
You know, there are certainly bills I would vote differently on. That's for sure.
For example.
I know there are bills that if I had to do it over, I would have. Right now I'm having trouble thinking of them. I know that's probably, you know, how we all like to think about the good things, but sure, there are votes I would do differently. But
so you're one of the people I can ask this question to. About the stadium. It has been docketed the worst deal in Nevada history. How do you feel about it? You're native of Nevada too. Where are you at going forward in state Senate now with this?
Well, during the special session, I was very torn about what was the right way to go on that issue. And up until, it was a 5-day special session. I think Thursday night, with all the concerns I had about traffic issues, I probably would have voted against it. But then Friday, hearing all the pleas for jobs and the investment in the community that it would bring, I did support it and I voted for it. And I still hope that it is going to turn out into something that helps our community and helps industry and helps our tax base. So I believe that it is coming, and I think that it will be an economic boom. And I supported it, and I hope that it will, bring what we hoped it would.
And how do we feel now with the controversy of the NFL, you know, with the kneeling of the anthem, with just the disregard of about it? How does that feel with our beautiful veterans community that we have here, that we're so proud of here in Nevada?
You know, I think we need to honor our veterans, and I think there's no question about that. As to what will happen with the stadium and the team when it comes, I really believe that people will come to Nevada and make it a weekend to come and see a game, whether it's the Packers playing or whoever team is here, and it'll help tourism in Nevada. I think that will happen. I really do think it'll help our community.
Could you explain to the listeners how a bill becomes a law and the committees that it has to pass through once it's written and then go to the Assembly and the Senate and then to the governor?
Absolutely.
How that happens.
A legislator like me or a committee chairman has to either come up with an idea or get an idea from a constituent or an organization that thinks that there's a need for a change in the law. Mm-hmm. And then you contact the bill drafting attorneys at the Legislative Council Bureau, and you talk to them about that law, and you see if they're, you know, maybe there's something already there, but if not, you ask them to draft the bill. And then hopefully it's ready by session start. If not, you sometimes get it a little bit after the beginning of session. And then you introduce it, it gets referred to a committee. Before you introduce it, you very often look for co-sponsors. For instance, when I introduced the bill on insurance coverage for autism, I tried to get every member of the Assembly and every member of the Senate. And I did, almost. I didn't get everyone. There were a few who were hesitant, who said, I don't want to sign on to this. But I did. And in the end, I think I got 38 or 39 Assembly people on that autism bill.
Awesome.
And I walked it around. I knocked on a lot of doors, and a lot of senior Assembly people said, come back. And then they never got back to me. Yeah. But that showed a lot of support.
Right.
And then it got referred to two different committees. It got referred to Health and Human Services, and it got referred to the Money Committee because of the impact.
The Ways and Means.
Right, the Ways and Means Committee. And then once I got it passed, the Assembly went over to the State Senate. Mm-hmm. And once we...
Is that the most powerful committee, the Ways and Means Committee, by the way?
Well, you know, it controls the purse strings.
Which one, the Judiciary or the Ways and Means?
You know, I think all the committees are powerful in different ways. I think Ways and Means is certainly a very important committee because it controls the purse strings of the state.
Okay.
But, with the bill on autism, when we finally got it to Governor Gibbons' desk, all the naysayers said he would veto it. And we were holding our breath every day waiting to see if he'd veto it. And finally he did sign it. And he signed it in the law, and it became a statute. Now it is the law that if for most insurance policies in Nevada, if you sell a policy to someone, it needs to cover treatment for your children who are on the spectrum.
Okay.
And that came from hearing testimony at this interim hearing from parents who said, I can't afford to get my child treatment, and what they're getting at school is not enough.
Are we going to get rid of these mopeds?
The mopeds. I don't think we're going to get rid of the mopeds. I actually, during the interim, I looked up the statute, and it says that a moped is defined as a two-wheeled vehicle that can travel not more than 30 miles an hour.
Why are they on our roads if the speed limit is
45?
Well,
how come they don't wear helmets if they want to be a motorcycle?
Well, the helmet law for motorcycles doesn't apply to mopeds.
Why? They could just fly off, same way of a motorcycle
person. Or get
hit
by somebody and there's your head.
The Senate Bill 404 did change the law on mopeds to require that they be registered. They weren't required to be registered before.
Yeah, I remember that.
There's, as far as I know,
to make fun of that.
Right.
They're on our roads and they're not paying any taxes.
I believe they're specifically excluded from being on urban freeways.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of all the rules of the road on our regular roads, I probably have to do a little more research on that. So I don't have the answer to that. I don't think we're going to get rid of them. I think that maybe there's a happy middle balance of keeping everybody safe.
Assemblyman Armstrong, we run out of time. Could you look into the camera and could you tell folks why they need to go to the polls and vote you in as a state senator? Because now that's the position you want, and your accomplishments that would give them some type of idea why they should go vote for you, and your point of contact, please.
Thank you very much. Steve, Christina, thank you for having me on the show. And I do appreciate everything you do for veterans. And I certainly look forward to the opportunity to try to work to help our veterans in the future legislative session. I do appreciate everyone's consideration in the upcoming election. And you can find out more about me at my website, which is jamesorenshaw.com. Thank you very much for having me on the show.
Did you have a real quick question you wanted to ask? Because you were like...
Oh, no.
Okay.
It'll be a very long question. Now, you know what? What is the one thing you hope to accomplish in state senate? If you get to accomplish one thing...
I think that, economic development and job growth, I think that if we can try to keep working on that, I see what's happening in Reno with Tesla and with the, you know, Panasonic, the factories, the high-tech factories that they've got up there, and the kind of growth that they have here up there. We tried it with Faraday, and unfortunately that it didn't work out like we'd hoped. Right. But I'd really like to see more of that happen down here, because I think we've got the brain power, the man and woman power, and I think that we've worked on legislation last several sessions that really tries to help veterans in terms of opportunities to work on these kind of projects. So I'd like to see more of that high-tech industry like we're seeing in Northern Nevada come here. Right. We tried with Faraday. That didn't work out like we hoped. But I'd like to see more of that.
Well, Assemblyman Entrell, thank you so much for coming on the program. Good luck with you with the state senate.
Thank
seat.
You,
and we'll be following you from now until then.
Thank you very much for having me on the show. Yes. Thank you,
folks. This Thanks is so much. This is Steve Sanson and Christina Ortiz with Veterans in Politics. Until next week.